All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is Monday. Welcome to Wide Awake Radio here on the Rents Radio Network. And even though Charlie is missing in action, I want to guarantee you an action-packed show because I am not here alone today. Reginald Kiegler, or better known as DEMCAD, is here with me today to help co-host and carry us on through. If you don't know who DEMCAD is, then you're missing out. He's over on YouTube. You can find him listed as DEMCAD. Great. He's a great young man. He's got a lot of good ideas. He tries to think for himself and think independently. So if you get half a second and you don't know his videos, please go over to YouTube and check the man out. DEMCAD, thank you for being here with me today.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm pretty excited about today's show. I'm still a little under the weather, but I have a lot to say. I look forward to speaking with you and talking to you about a number of issues.
Well, you know, I think we're gonna kind of delve into some economy because, as always, you're always talking about unemployment, economy, the different numbers that are used, the different polling agencies that, or the different what they call statistics bureaus, which are used in these phony, funny, fake numbers. So, I'm using their numbers today, and as we move a little bit away from that, I have a trivia question for you, and I couldn't answer it, so don't feel bad if you can't. Who is the number one job employer in growth in America since 2009, and I'll help you out. I'll give you some more information. Since 2009, they have created more jobs than anyone else at just over 21,000 new employees. This year, they're slated to open up 625 new stores with 6,000 new employees. Can you guess who this store is?
Yeah, originally I was going to say the federal government, but they've been pretty much the only ones really hiring for a while, but you know, I know Walmart's sales are actually decreasing, but I can only imagine that they're the only ones who, either them or Home Depot, they're the only ones I can imagine who are still open up stores.
I pondered the same things, Reggie, and guess what? It's the dollar store.
Ah, which dollar store? Dollar Tree?
No, the one that's called Dollar Store.
Oh.
Believe it or not, things have gotten so bad that the dollar store is the front runner.
Well, it used to be Walmart, but like I said, their sales have actually been down a little bit because they're saying that basically our customers don't have the money. So I'm trying to think of who's actually been growing. And, yeah, it would be the dollar stores because that's what I'm finding myself going to now. I'm able to find some pretty decent deals, you know. As you guys know, I like to prep for emergencies in case there's ever, like, a disaster or whatever. And I buy a lot of bandages. And even I found a digital thermometer at a dollar store for bucks. So, I mean, you'll find some pretty good deals. I understand why people are going.
Well, yeah, you know, I mean, as we look at the economy and the, you know, we could talk about the phony, fictitious numbers. I mean, if you add 50 in, but you subtract 75 spaces from the barrel, you know what I mean? Unemployment's going to go down and things like that. But I mean, Sears is now once again still in trouble, looking to close 79 stores across the country. And listen to this one. This is the next big one to fall apart. Kodak is in panic mode. They're having wholesale of their patents. They're actually selling their patents off to try and generate the cash to stay afloat.
Well, I mean, that doesn't surprise me. First of all, Sears and Kmart. One thing I noticed about Kmart is that their prices are way too high. It's not a high-end store, but their prices are much higher than Walmart. And I know that's definitely been hurting them, at least in our neck of the woods. But, you know, it's not just the lower-end stores that are suffering. You have places like Best Buy, which I consider to be a superior store to a lot of stores. Of course, Circuit City failed a long time ago. But Best Buy, what's interesting is that when you look at their same-store sales compared to the year before, there was actually a 1.2% decrease in sales. Their online sales increased by 26%, and their appliances increased by around 14%, but their software decreased by 19% or somewhere around there. And basically, it was actually a pretty flat month for December. Well, the latest reports are showing it was very flat. So it's not just the lower end stores. It's, you know, we're finding out that these numbers weren't that great all across the board. And as far as the unemployment rate going down, people have to understand that the reason why they're bringing down the unemployment rate is because they're getting rid of the amount of the people who are actually considered to be unemployed. It's not as though they're actually finding jobs or anything. It's just that during a holiday season, a lot of these people end up with these part-time seasonal jobs, but more importantly, they eliminate a large segment of the unemployed from the actual population. You can sort of gauge this by looking at, even at the government numbers, you notice that out of all the people unemployed, 42.5% of them have been long-term unemployed. Basically, 27 weeks or longer. So what's happening is these middle-class jobs are being replaced with, you know, marginal, no benefits, low-paying jobs, and people can't really survive off of that. So, I mean, that's what's really happened with the unemployment rate. And there's a big difference between the unemployment and the unemployment rate. I just wanted to point that out.
Oh, absolutely. I completely and totally agree. They always, you know, this thing where people discourage workers, they don't even count self-employed workers. I mean, if you're self-employed, then you're automatically employed. You know, your numbers go in the plus category. But they don't actually say whether or not you're making any money or you're actually doing any work, because I know the self-employed people are taking a heavy hit. People just don't evaporate, you know, out of the workforce. They still need jobs. You know, what was different about them last month to this month? You know what I mean? This 150,000 people that just seem to evaporate into thin air. I mean, did they leave the country? You know, they don't ever tell you why they get removed from the workforce. You know, they didn't actually get a job, but they're gone anyways. So, you know, it's kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, you can look at the employment population ratio and see that it hasn't really changed in the last year. It's pretty flat.
Yeah, and there was something else too, you know, as we bounce around here, but there was something that was kind of that kind of wanted to touch base on with you, because you talk about the police state and preparing for it. And I saw a story in where Michigan is paying a lot of attention to New York and what New York is about ready to do, but it seems that the governor of New York and that the TSA are teaming up, and Michigan is reviewing their files as this comes together to see if Michigan wants to take part. But now, for all, including nonviolent crimes, they want to demand DNA sampling, profiling, and categorization in a database network of all criminals convicted. That means drunk driving, you know, if you get a nickel bag of marijuana, it doesn't matter. If you're convicted, you will give a DNA sample, and the New York State government is teaming up with it. What do you think about that, and how do you feel about your state that you're in, watching all fang dripping as New York puts this together? I mean, I guess that means Michigan will be next. How do you feel about all that?
I remember reading a story about the UK, how they were collecting DNA samples of people who were arrested. But even people who were exonerated, they kept those DNA samples. So when I hear stories like this, I wonder, where is it really going to be limited to? Is it just going to be limited to people who are actually being convicted? And if so, how can this be used against the people in the future? So this is what I originally think of. We already have some unconstitutional things happening here in Michigan. And I know there's a big partisan battle between the Republican governor and the Democrats who are opposed to this the Emergency Manager Act. Basically, the governor, he signed a new law that allowed him to appoint emergency managers that were going to cities and completely fire public officials and take over the towns. So I'm already suspicious about the motives of the state.
Well, I would definitely agree. There were several people who have talked about it. They've talked about this databasing going into effect. You know, lots of people, you know, the whole Viper squads, you know, that's one of the code names for the TSA outside of transportation terminals. People don't even realize that Tennessee last year, right at the end of the year, kicked off a large program working with the TSA to have roving checkpoints and roving TSA patrol vehicles. TSA actually have patrol vehicles now on the street, and the TSA, when people were talking about the body scanners and everybody was focused on these body scanners, the one major piece of technology that they didn't talk about was an infrared and x-ray style device that was added to the sides of police light bars at a laptop mounted in the TSA vehicle, where they can actually x-ray through the vehicle next to it as it drives down the road.
That's crazy. I never heard anything like that. That's really crazy.
You should go and actually research it, because everybody was so focused on the body scanners, nobody paid attention to these vehicle scanners. And the TSA has now launched this program, and they call it the Viper Team, in Tennessee, and they're looking to move to New York, New Jersey, Michigan, Ohio, and several other states to expand their program, because, you know, somebody might hide a nuclear bomb on a Greyhound bus.
I mean, it's crazy. I know you wanted to talk about Ron Paul, which I, you know, first of all, if this guy's serious about becoming the next president of the United States, he's going to have to beef up his efforts. I know he's only 76 years old, but if this guy wants to really win, he's going to have a lot more public appearances. When is his next public appearance? What, on Friday? He's going to have to step it up to the extreme, because he is not a favorite of the establishment. And I just want to say this about the whole establishment, and it applies to Democrats as well. Now, these guys are selected before they're ever elected. Before you even get anywhere near the voting booth, they already select the people they want. And I think Rick Santorum, or whatever his name is, he's only there to serve a specific purpose. He's just a pawn. And I think we saw that in Iowa when he came out of nowhere from single digits, a guy who isn't very likable at all, if you ever seen him on television, a guy who was a disaster in Pennsylvania when he ran for the Senate again in 2006. What, he lost by 18 points? Obviously, he's not a guy who really appeals to the electorate. The guy, in 1 week period, went from single digits almost to, what, almost 25%? He just blew up in the polls, just jumped out of nowhere and magically surpassed Ron Paul. And people don't get how skewed the system is. First of all, there's a reason why Iowa has to be the first one. First election. Because it's a small-ass state, and it's not even a real primary. It's a caucus, which means the GOP or the DNC party people can control how the votes are reported and how they actually swing. The more you research a caucus, the more you understand what I'm talking about. Same thing with New Hampshire. It's a reason why they want small states in the beginning to be the states that are represented to have momentum. You hear that? You hear those keywords in the media a lot, because they want to control the situation by dumping all their money into it and putting their party people in place and controlling who wins what and the perception.
And, you know, you're 100% correct. And actually, if you go on YouTube, several people have posted this. They have reposted it from the people who originally posted it. And you can actually hear two different interviews with these ladies. And they basically demonstrate through verbal communication to these news media that they're talking to that the structure of the Republican Party is doing all it can to get Ron Paul out of the race, because they know that the people really don't want him to represent them. And they go through this whole interview about how there's meetings taking place with these delegates and these officials and the Electoral College individuals, and how they're making these decisions to derail and get Ron Paul out. And, well, hey, lo and behold, I thought the illusion was that people elected these people. So, I mean, you're 100% right, DEMCAD. If you, they're even openly admitting it now in the media, that the structure of the two parties, well, the structure, namely, of the Republican Party, is doing everything it can to stop Ron Paul.
Well, I mean, they want to control the entire environment. That's why Michigan and Florida or some other big state doesn't go first. It's very important that it's Iowa, a caucus, a really small, controlled environment. It's really important that that goes first so the media can uplift the winner of that controlled environment. And then New Hampshire, something that's also a state. Now, I'm not knocking New Hampshire, but it's very, very small. And there's a reason why it's chosen to come second, or why it's always protected, because they want small environments that they can absolutely control. Rick Santorum, his job was to come in second. They needed Ron Paul to finish third or lower so they can justify ignoring him. Because had he came in a close second, or had he won, it would have been more awkward for them to try to ignore this guy who won by saying that, well, you know, he's not a part of really the competition. This is why I said I didn't think he could actually win. Not because I wasn't convinced that he couldn't win more votes. It's because they control the system. It's their game. Okay, they can control how things are reported, and you're seeing that happen right here. And that's why I was sort of cynical about that. But that's all I had to say about the whole Ron Paul, the whole GOP election machine.
Well, definitely, you know, I do agree with you, and people should, you know, personally, if you're going to vote, if you're going to take part, you vote for the, you know, the right man that matches the principles and ideas of what you come with, not with who you think can win, not with anything else. You should actually vote your principles and your conscience, you know, the person that best represents you. Now, to me, I would vote, if I was going to, the person who best represented the constitutional and the natural common law. But there is one thing that set a record on January 2nd. There was 3.2 million ounces of silver sold on January 2nd of 2012.
And what was the latest record? I mean, how does that compare to a typical day?
The average exchange day that they were comparing it to for the record was 2.6 million. And this, it shot all the way up to 3.2 million ounces.
Wow. And who's buying this?
Organizations? This silver marking is private sector sales. This is people who are, yes, some of it is paper, some of it is silver futures and silver stock, and some of it is actual precious metals in your hand. But this number did not include corporate or government purchases. This was a number strictly from what they call the private sector buyout. In other words, people like you and me. So on January 2nd, everybody took their Christmas money, went down, and bought themselves some silver, is basically what it looks like to me, because this is not corporate sales. These are private sector sales. So to me, it looks like somebody basically wrapped up all their Christmas money and said, let's get some precious metals. Now, granted, some of that was in paper and futures, which I don't think people should do. I think you should be stacking right in front of you where you can see it.
I don't think it's silver. But that's my I'm not offering investment advice. I'm just saying I don't want paper guns or paper ammunition.
And I agree with you. I agree with you 100%. Definitely not offering you financial advice. Don't want to get accused of that. But I will tell you, for me, if I'm not stacking it, then it ain't really there.
Yeah, I don't think people were buying gold and silver. You know what? For the holidays, I think people were buying Xbox 360, video games, PlayStation 3, DVDs and Blu-rays, toys, TVs. That's what I think people were buying, whether they had the money to pay the bills or not. It sounds crazy, but I think that's what people were spending their money on. And, you know, if you have a house full of kids and you don't have any extra food stored up, you may be in for a big surprise.
Yeah, you know, I can't stress enough people to be prepared for the issues. I mean, I know if you have extra money and you want to do the different things that you want to do.
Yeah, I'm not against you. Oh, I have a PlayStation 3 right here. I have my hand on it right now. I'm not against PlayStation 3. It's just that, you know, maybe before I buy another game, it might make sense to have enough ammunition. Maybe before I buy another Wii, I might want to have some extra food stored in the house. If I have kids, it's just a thought. I mean, that's just how I view things. But, hey, you know, I may be off on this. And by the way, while we're talking about gold and paper and stuff, you know, I came across a story of the Illinois lottery system. Basically, there's about 85 winners, $159,000 in winnings, and these people went to cash their checks, and they bounced. Oh, wait, they didn't bounce, somebody said. Somebody said that, oh, it was an accounting, it was an error. Somebody didn't type in the right code. Or that was an excuse that the Illinois lottery provided. It didn't bounce, it was returned. Oh, okay, it was returned. Because somebody didn't type in the right code. I mean, I don't care what's their excuse. Okay, if I give you a check and it doesn't go through, I mean, we can call it whatever you want. As far as I'm concerned, a check bounced. Okay, so I don't know why it did that, but, you know, Illinois is a state with a reputation for owing a lot of money. So I just want people to know that, you know, be very careful. You don't know what's actually going on with these organizations. And I think MF Global, you know, is just one of those organizations where, you know, the money might not be used the way you think it's being used.
Well, yeah, I mean, they tell you it's for, you know, it's like the lottery system, period. The government tells you that it's being used for education, and it's like, okay, well, if all of this money is being generated, we're talking with me and America, the lovely family, and Reginald Kugler from the DEMCAD channel over on YouTube. We were talking a lot about finance. We talked a little bit about money. We talked a little bit about elections and so forth, kind of a hodgepodge in and out. If you guys want to...
Can we throw that number out for everybody if you want to call in? Number is 877-342-6673. Again, 877-342-6673.
Just want to make sure that number. Absolutely. That was just about what I was getting ready to do. So if anybody has any, if you want to talk to me, if you want to ask DEMCAD any questions, you want to pose something to us to discuss, anything of that nature, that number is 877-342-6673. Once again, please feel free to pick up the phone, call us. They'll get you on the phone live with Eric Lovely and DEMCAD. It's kind of weird to talk about myself in third person. But as we talked about finance and whatnot in the first half, we both have two, what I would say, disturbing portions to the same coin of war. As I have seen it, I will start. There is the naval buildup in and around Syria. The supposed, it's not a deployment now, it's a training exercise, but you have a buildup of troops on the Turkish border where there are also supposedly 15 to 20,000 rebel fighters. They haven't given them an actual name, they just call them rebel fighters, who are attempting to ensure France's safe corridor of goods and access to the people of Syria. You see that going on, and you see this buildup there, so you're talking with this approximately 10,000 American military buildup and 15 to 20,000 freedom fighters, whoever they are, because no one wants to name them yet. You're looking at about 30,000 troops built up on the border of Turkey there. And you also have the naval buildup. And people are asking, well, is this World War III? And I said, well, we'll have to see, the wait till the next shoe drops. And then I talked to you before the show, and we start talking about what I view as the next shoe. And so we're going to move over. And Reggie, tell us a little bit about what's going on in Israel.
Well, RT is reporting that essentially thousands of U.S. Troops are being deployed to Israel, and they're being deployed for an exercise, a drill, a military exercise. This is the largest joint missile drill by these two countries, the U.S. and Israel, that they pretty much ever had, the largest ever. And they're focusing on installations with American troops, and they're actually going to... It's beginning to look a lot like an actual deployment. I don't know how many thousands, because I'm going over this article, and it simply says thousands. I'll put a link in there for you guys to check out on your own. But thousands of American soldiers are going to be involved with some type of exercise. This comes after Iran had their own 10-day exercise, naval exercise, near the Afghan border. So, you know, things are moving along. I don't know if this indicates there's going to be an attempt, any type of operation by the U.S. and Israel aimed at Syria or Iran. But we do know that Syria received some hardware from Russia. They received some supersonic missiles, anti-ship missiles, pretty recently. I don't know if you heard about that. Things are escalating.
The missiles are actually developed by Iran. They got anti-aircraft technology from Russia in that package deal. So the Iranians, supposedly with Russian scientists, helped develop these missiles that basically skim just off of the top of the water, and they're designed to kill ships. That's what they're designed for. And then, as you and I were talking about earlier, about the M300, which is a new super technology anti-aircraft platform created by Russia and sold to Iran, in a billions of dollar weapons deal. And now you have this consorted, I don't know, what do you want to call it? To me, it looks like a deployment, just like you were telling me, because I started trying to look at some of the information and the different detachments that were going over there. I mean, with the present information that's on the board, how far away do you think a breakout of a real large-scale war is?
$30 billion in F-15 American warplanes are going to Saudi Arabia. They're sending, U.S. is sending hardware to Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates to sort of offset Iran. So, you know, you have that, and behind that you have the U.S. involvement in Iraq, you have, which is pretty much to the west or southwest of Iran. And then you have off to the east a little bit, you have also sharing a border with Iran, you have American operations in Afghanistan. So it seems to me that the U.S. has been targeting, or at least surrounding, Iran for a while. And I think their efforts are to prevent Iran from sharing oil and resources with China. And China's economy is rapidly modernizing and expanding, although they hit a rough patch recently. They're going to need a lot of oil to really modernize their economy. They have, a billion people? And you have Russia, who also wants to have access to certain areas. I think the U.S. is trying to block Iran from that. And I think if Russia and China wants to fight World War III with the U.S., they're in a situation where they're going to have to fight the Americans in World War III. Iran's going to be really important. They're going to have some type of access to the Middle East. It's a good strategic point to be able to go through Afghanistan or Pakistan and to actually move resources in and out of Iran. Now, I think the U.S. is trying to marginalize their ability to do so by cutting them off. So I think they're already sort of they're taking steps to sort of prevent the others from gaining an advantage in a war. So I think that whoever positions themselves best before the war will be most likely to come out in a stronger position. I don't want to say winning, because if this turns into a thermonuclear war, I don't know how you really win. Something like that. I understand Russia, they have plenty of nuclear weapons. They have intercontinental ballistic missiles that can obviously reach the U.S. And they have a very massive and capable Navy. They spend a lot of money on tanks, even before the Soviet Union fell apart. You have China that's trying to modernize their military. So you have world powers that are moving into a direction where they're fighting over resources. And it seems like war is the direction in which they're going in. I don't know if it's going to be 2 years from now or 20 years from now, but I think it depends on what happens with the resources and access to resources. I think as soon as Russia and China finds a way to get around the U.S. dollar and defeat the U.S. dollar in terms of U.S. dollar being the world reserve currency, because countries have agreed to sell their oil in U.S. dollars, and the ones who don't, like Iraq, they tried to sell theirs in euros, and we went after them. And Libya tried to sell their oil. They were trying to organize a deal to sell their oil in gold, and we went after them as well. But once that U.S. dollar supremacy is challenged, then I think other countries will be in a better position to challenge the U.S. And I think that's possibly happening.
I think that's definitely, because there's several points I want to make to back that statement up. The Federal Reserve System, what we call the Federal Reserve Bank, which right now makes the reserve currency of the world because everything trades in dollars. Well, see, the Federal Reserve System is the scapegoat, and they're trying to bring in the IMF to take over and make people believe that it's somehow something new and different. Well, Russia and China and Iran and some of the Asiatic countries all in throughout there have now, instead of merging and giving power to the IMF, they've now brokered deals to start trading in the ruble and the yuan and their own private currencies, which makes them an enemy of the New World Order. Not that they're good guys, but they're not siding with the IMF broker takeover of the world. And, you know, people say, well, how do you know this is happening? You know, all you have to do is look at Greece right now. When the IMF put in their stooge, I mean their man for president, what he's done is he signed a bill to back the bonds of their country, of their nation, with Greece state-owned property, islands, businesses, all of these things. So if their bond market fails, the IMF can now take the natural resources of that country. And the bailout money that's being used in that country is actually being used to buy military hardware. It's not being used to save the nation's populace.
Yeah, I was thinking about that, Greece and their situation. When I read that, I thought that was a typo. I read it on Zero Hedge, talking about bailout money in Greece being used to buy German U-boats. I mean, that's what I read. I'm like, what? American Apache helicopters? I mean, is this really happening?
Well, of course, that's exactly what's going on. I mean, when you look at it, basically what the IMF does, and the central banking idea, I mean, they're the same people that created the Federal Reserve. Well, not the exact same people, but the same type of mindset, the same type of Keynesian bankers. So what they do is they go into a country, they destabilize the currency and so forth by giving it debt and debt that it can't pay back, and then they give it a bailout, force you to give up more of that national resources, but they have stipulations on what you can spend the money on. So to become a strong partner for the IMF and the EU, they were required to spend the bailout money on PT boats, U-boats. Everybody from, you know, that knows anything about World War II would know what a U-boat is, and these Apache attack helicopters. Now, I'm not sure if you have your currency and your bonds being backed up by your natural resources, and then you get a bailout and you're blowing it on not your nation, you're blowing it on military hardware. I mean, that's just an equation for disaster.
It's a scam. It's an absolute scam. It's just like, oh, we need to bail out the too big to fails to save the economy, but they just took the money from the people and gave it to the banks. I mean, it's just outright thievery.
That's exactly what it is. You know, it's complete and utter thievery. But and at the same time that all of these things are going on, with this crazy military products being sold all over the world, you know, all this money being thrown around, and there is still such a large percentage of the population that are just, I don't know. I mean, I want to say it nice, but I mean, they seem just mentally inept.
Well, I mean, yeah, that is a nice way of putting it. I think because they created a paradigm that relies so much on not only oil, but obviously it looks like pretty much war, it's almost like they actually need war to try to save their own paradigm, because that's all their paradigm is being created for, is for really destruction, the idea of destruction and growth. That seems to be two common things with their paradigm. So how do they continue this with their wars, because obviously the economic systems are failing, because economies are being sabotaged by these same banker corporate interests operating on a transnational scale but operating within the country. How do they get their wars without destroying the human race, it seems to me? Or are they doing this as just a means of is almost like a habit to them, or is it something that's sort of organized so that they're doing this because they want to reduce the population and control the situation? I mean, what do you think their plan is? It seems an absolutely, I want to say insane, but that's a legal term. It's immoral, and it seems disturbing and almost like they're psychotic.
It's nuts, Reggie. It's exactly what it is. But, you know, the people that were, if you go back and you read the book that was produced in 1894, it's called Propaganda. And if you look at that book, there are several chapters on what they call situational rationalization, where morals and principles can be rationalized one direction or the other. There's no such thing as right and wrong anymore, and they put this into our schools, and they continue to perpetuate the same type of people into leadership. Well, these people who are perpetuated into leadership, they believe in the eugenics program. They believe that there are people's betters and there are people's lessers, and that the useless eaters, you should only keep as many of them as you need to serve the elite, the intelligent, and the rest of them are cannon fodder and can be wiped off the planet. War provides them with the best tool to gain control, fiat currency and war, because they go in and they blow up and destroy the country. Then they pump, for the people who are left in that country, they pump it full of debt. They require you to give them all of your natural resources and all the control over your country. And they just rinse and repeat the cycle over and over again to shrink the population and to demonstrate more and more control over these individual nations as they build towards a one-world technocrat society. I mean, if you read the books on eugenics, if you read what the Rockefellers and all of these people who created these NGOs, and they run around spending all this money, if you read Bill Gates' statements, all these billionaires upon billionaires who spend these monies in these wars and in these banking fiascos, their physical belief, written down in black and white, is that the world needs to be reduced to under a million people. I mean, you know, or to a half, to under a billion people.
The number varies from about 500 million to a billion people.
Yeah, it's somewhere in that department, but they all strongly believe that. And no matter which camp you fall into, whether it's 500 million get to stay alive or a billion get to stay alive, well, here's a newsflash. I think there's, 7.2 billion people on the planet or something like that now, depending on which numbers you look at. That means no matter what, at least 6 billion people have to die.
And, I think what they're trying to do is set up scenarios where it's impossible for people to take care of themselves or very difficult for people to take care of themselves and therefore have to depend on systems. And then they can sabotage the systems. And when the systems fail, the people have no means of taking care of themselves and therefore the populations collapse. Well, that may be an idea that some of them have. But
believe it or not, Reggie, there's a strategy. It's called the Cloward-Piven strategy. The Russians used it, the communists, the Marxists have used it for a long time. You just described it to a T. It's actually called the Cloward-Piven strategy, and it is in play. Your opinion of what you think is going on is actually a well-known Marxist strategy that has been around for a few hundred years now, and it's in play right now. And I would love to hear your opinion in a video on that, but that is what is going on as I see it. You actually see them enacting the strategy, and if you look at the strategy, what it does is it says saddle the country with as much debt as possible and make the people so poor, so downtrodden that they buckle to what you want. And, you know, if you look at it, that's what has been done. We have continued to mount more and more debt and more and more debt and more and more debt over decades upon decades upon decades to the point now where people are losing hope, people are starving, people are losing their homes. I mean, how much ability do they really have to resist?
100%. The actual retirement of a debt that the government has for their retirement programs and the money they owe to creditors and their IOUs, this doesn't include all of their obligations, just so we're clear. But the money that the federal government owes, excluding a lot of their obligations, is what, about $15 trillion, well, $14 trillion. I forgot what it was, $14.23 trillion. And it's 100% of the gross domestic product. What that means is the size of the economy for 1 year, the entire size of the economy, that's what they're saying, how much money the federal government owes. And if you calculate all of their obligations, a lot of people come up with numbers closer to $50 trillion and even higher than that. I mean, that's how much debt has been created. I mean, just look at what's happening with all these other countries. Now, the IMF comes in to a country, and they're like, okay, we'll give you loans for this program and this and that, right? And the government's agreed to it. Government's selling people out. The whole thing is structured so they can't pay it back. And then, oh, you can't pay it back? Oh, well, we come in here, and we're going to take over your natural resources and take over everything that's valuable in your country, right? Even though we pretty much stole the money to begin with. I mean, it's an incredible scheme.
It is, and I want to throw one more fact in there to get your final word as the show is going to be coming to a close soon. Here's another thing that most people don't even realize. If you remember, what was it, just a few months ago, the debt ceiling issue? Do you realize as of today, we're 23.6 million from that debt ceiling raise? I mean, we're already at the cap out point again. Just, what was it, 3 months ago? 4 months ago, we raised the debt ceiling. I can't remember how many months ago, and we already have met the debt ceiling again. We're within under 25 million of the debt ceiling. Once again, here we are.
Absolutely. They're going to keep doing this and doing this until somewhere in Russia and China until Russia and China comes up with an alternative. And once they come up with an alternative and people no longer have to go with the U.S. dollar, then that's what I think it's going to be over with.
And I think that that will spell war. I mean, they won't have much other choice. If they want to project their hegemony and they want to stay in the driver's seat and be, quote-unquote, the world elite making all the decisions, that the only point that they'll have at that point is to go with, to war with the nations that are going a different direction. And, you know, Zbigniew Brzezinski just said last year, you know, we've come to a political point in history where it's far easier to kill a million people than it is to attempt to control a million people.
Absolutely. I mean, look what happened after the Great Depression. Well, I mean, during the Great Depression, I should say. A lot of people say that, oh, well, you know, FDR pulled us out of the Great Depression, which I laugh at sometimes. But, hey, I wasn't there, so I'm not going to talk too much about it. But we all have our own opinions. I wasn't there. But I do know that one of the things they did was turn to a world war. Now, whether you believe the world war helped us get out of the Great Depression or not, that's what they turned to. They turned to war. When their economies, they turned to war.
That's exactly what happened. And actually, ending the war, who actually did more for saving it, because when they started the war, I mean, I'll go ahead and say it because I'm not shy. That idiot that was in office, all he did was print, print, print. He started printing like it was going out of style. And yeah, it looked good on the front end, but here we sit today. $15.6 or $15.2 trillion in debt, and, you know, where 100% of the GDP is just pretty much squirted away if you're going to, you know, to try and pay this back. I mean, that means not paying the light bills, not paying for product, not paying for anything. It means just turning 100% over to the bank.